Good morning. Welcome to worship. We up front, we'll probably take off our masks some as we're behind the screen and keep a distance. So welcome to all of you who are here in person in the Steiner Hall. And we invite you to follow along in your bulletins. Welcome also to those who are joining us virtually from home. We welcome you. Thank you for being here. I'm Pastor Dale Peterson. Pastor Katie Escalante, she'll be reading the message today. So we welcome you to worship. Thank you to our primetime band for leading us in worship. And we'll have our gathering song, Come, Now Is the Time to Worship. Turn them into wheat Hartford. May we love as you love. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite Shannon Anderson, our children, youth, and family minister, to come forward, and also those children ages 3 and up who do not have a Spark Bible. If you grab a Spark Bible on the way in, great. Parents, you should be holding it at the beginning and come up. And if you want to grab all the Bibles on the table here, you can do that. So, Bible presentation. Adults, come with the kids. And we'll have that. Is there any kids during this one that are going to come up? We have one. Perfect. You can represent. Everyone's so great. Here's Chris.
Kids are kids, and we welcome them here at Faith Lutheran. Our first reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. The Apostle Paul writes, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Our gospel comes from John 15, verses 12 through 17. On the eve of his death, Jesus is having a meal with his friends, his disciples, and this is what he says. "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We are continuing our three-week sermon series, Everyday Spirituality, by the book from that same name by author James Hazelwood, Bishop, ELCA Bishop of the New England Synod. And so last week, Pastor Dale talked about things we do every day, spiritual actions that happen every day of our lives. This week, we're focusing on things we do weekly, every week spirituality, if you will. And I have to admit that as I went through my week thinking about this sermon, I kept noting, oh yeah, that was in the book. That was about every week spirituality. The first chapter in a section is called Friend. Hazelwood shares the story of a woman who reconnected with old friends after realizing she was needing deeper friendships. And every week they gather for a trivia night. And she said, it's really not about the trivia. It's about the time spent with friends. And so he asked her, do you all talk about faith when you get together? And she paused before answering and said, if you mean religion or God or church, then I have to say no, not really. But if you mean life and hopes and disappointments, then I'd say definitely. In our gospel reading this morning, Jesus is sharing a meal with his disciples. On the eve of his death, he says to them, love one another as I have loved you. And he says, I have called you friends. Everything we have in the New Testament are Jesus' teachings and conversations that the gospel writers felt were pertinent for our faith formation. It's what we needed to know for our faith. But there's this great little line in John's gospel that says, you know what, there's so much more that wasn't written down because there would be volumes and volumes we couldn't include it all. And I like to think that in all those unwritten words, that Jesus hung out with his closest friends for 3 years. So they talked about a whole lot more than what we have in the gospel. I think they talked about families, about childhoods, the weather, a local athletic event, sporting event that they've been to, probably arguing over how best to prepare fresh fish, and life, and hopes, and disappointments. I was thinking about this chapter yesterday as one of our groups of friends that we met while we were living in Peru and now live throughout Twin Cities. We gathered together for probably our last time. We've been trying to do outdoor gatherings, physically distancing, and the weather's getting a little cold. And I said, you know, I'm sorry, but we're going to have to leave early. I've got to finish a sermon, this sermon. And they said, very kindly, well, what are you preaching about? And I thought for a moment, kind of, okay, What's the pastoral answer, right? What's the big theological thing I'm supposed to be saying? And thinking of this chapter on friendship as an everyday spirituality, I looked at my friends and we all kind of hung out and said, this, time with friends, talking about the ups and downs, joys and challenges of life, and how this too is spiritual, how God is present here too, even when we aren't talking about God and religion and churchy things. Hazelwood's next chapter is called Trust, and it builds on this theme of friendship and talks about those relationships that are really long-term. I'm lucky to have a best friend who I've known since I was 3. So it's been a while. And we've been through a lot of ups and downs, right? It's the process of getting to know somebody else is rewarding and challenging part of life. Hazelwood calls it a spiritual practice in and of itself. Those who have been in long-term partnerships and marriage know that it's that long-term relationship that helps us to kind of see what our rough edges are and help ground them out, is what Luther said about marriage. The process of building and rebuilding trust is at the core of our relationships and our work with whom we live and share our lives. And I think Paul's reading this morning from Ephesians is really how we do that. We do it with humility and gentleness, with patience, and we bear with one another in love. And sometimes over the years and decades of friendships and relationships, bearing with one another seems like we're bearing with one another. And sometimes it's a lot easier to do. It's in those long-term relationships. If you've gone through a hard time, you know that when friends and family come and support you, it's like Jesus with skin on. That God shows up in those people for us, loving us and supporting us and walking with us through those challenging moments. His next chapter is called Question. He says, questions are healthy, meaningful ways for human beings to learn and grow and challenge one another. Questions are among the greatest assets in our efforts to rediscover everyday spirituality. Jesus was always asking questions of his disciples, of the crowds who followed him, those who came to him seeking answers, and even those who challenged him. He often met them with a question. As parents of a young child, we know it's part of human development. This is normal. And in our household, we enter the but why phase. So everything is met with the but why question or some other question. Parents probably know what I'm talking about. It's but why is the bird singing? But why is the sun still asleep when I am awake? But why are there clouds? It goes on, right? And it's never ending. Sometimes I think the right answer is, I don't know that one. And it isn't only children who question. Our current 10th graders are preparing for their confirmation, which was postponed from the spring, and they all wrote faith statements. And then they sign up to have interviews with Pastor Dale, myself, Allie, and Shannon. And I had a number of those interviews this week. And as part of their faith statements, we ask, what questions do you still have? What questions do you wrestle with? And they've got some good, hard questions. Like, does God really have a plan for everything? And did God create everything, even evil? How about, is there a sin too big for God to forgive? And one I particularly like, can I just see a miracle or a healing to know for sure? Their questions have led to great conversations, and I look forward to the other interviews we have coming up. I think as adults, we sometimes forget that we're allowed to question. We're allowed to wonder. Or we feel like somehow to show how strong our faith is, we can't have any doubt. We can't leave room for the questions. Anne Lamott, a book we recently read, said, the opposite of faith isn't doubt, but certainty. The opposite of faith isn't doubt, but certainty. So as I say to our students preparing for confirmation, I don't have all the answers. And actually, I still have a lot of questions. And God is big enough for your questions. Mature faith, Hazelwood says, is rooted in questions every day. Then he goes on to talk about cooking and how some of us love to cook, some of us absolutely loathe it, and most of us fall somewhere in between. And I'd say I'm either between loving it or somewhere in between. You know, it depends on the schedules, how much time, are we in a rush, who are we preparing a meal for, all those things. And as many of you know, I spent a few years living in Peru, so I did have some wonderful Peruvian host families and other women who taught me how to cook some Peruvian dishes. My husband Jose is also a fabulous cook. But as two working parents with a young child, life is full, life is busy. And so often we're just trying to get something on the table. But about once a week, one of us takes the time to prepare a Peruvian meal. It typically is a lot more labor intensive, lots of fresh ingredients and cutting and chopping and preparing, tons of different spices, layers and steps of how to put it all together. It's typically a Saturday or Sunday afternoon activity, and we share a meal from the other place we call home. And it reminds us of our family and our community there. It helps us to feel connected across the distance. Hazelwood says when we cook, we are connected to the earth, to the garden, the plants and animals, all of life. The Bible is full of meals being prepared and shared. It was one of Jesus' favorite pastimes, after all. And I know many of you have secret family recipes or a special family tradition around food. For some, it's cookies or a special holiday dish or a certain way of rolling the latzah. When we cook or bake or stir the pot, we are connecting over time with our families, with ancient traditions and peoples, and with God's abundance. Hazelwood's next chapter is about walking. Walking is biblical. Turns out in the Bible days they didn't have Uber. The Israelites walked and wandered in the desert for 40 years en route to the Promised Land. Somebody needed to get them a GPS. And Jesus and his friends also walked from place to place. And studies have shown the benefits of a 30-minute walk every day for both our physical and emotional well-being, right? I wear a step calendar that also says, are you getting your active minutes in? 30 minutes, 5 days a week is the goal, something like that. It's good for our well-being, but it's also good for our spirit. Rabbi Abraham Heschel, when he marched with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. from Selma to Montgomery in the Civil Rights Movement, trying to get our black family the right to vote, he said, as we were marching, particularly across the bridge in Selma, our feet were praying. Our feet were praying. And we walk every day. You all walk from your cars into the building. You walk from the building to your cars. You got out of bed, walked to the kitchen, got some coffee. Every time you're walking, your feet can be praying. Everyday spirituality. Then Hazelwood talks about singing, but really it's music in general. Music is sacred, whether we listen to it, sing it, and create it, as the band does. Faith Lutheran has been blessed with extraordinary musical talent over our 50 years. And some of our hymns, either the music or the lyrics, go back over hundreds of years. Some of the words of our hymns were written down and sung before Jesus was born. And then some of our Christian songs were learned around a campfire at camp. And it's not just Christian music that's holy and sacred. It's all music. On internship in Chelan, Washington, the pianist there, Rolf Dagdahl, he said that he knew God was real and is good because of music. And then explained that really, for communication purposes, we only need very basic tones to be able to, you know, say our point, communicate and understand one another, but that the rich variety of notes and tones and harmonies and rhythms are beautiful beyond necessity. Beautiful beyond necessity because God is good. And music is a part of everyday spirituality. Music helps us to worship, but it also helps us to celebrate helps us to grieve, helps us to face all of life's experiences. I think about one of my friends when she was in a bad breakup. And a few of us gathered and we just listened to sad breakup songs. We didn't even really talk. We didn't even really do much. We just listened to some music together. And she said that was one of the most healing nights for her. Music. His next chapter is travel. He says travel upends and challenges and alters your worldview. Any travel is a pilgrimage. Pilgrimage is a spiritual engagement with the unknown, with the new. I've been very fortunate in my life to travel. So far, I've been to 5 of 7 continents, but the bucket list of places to go is still very long. And on every trip and every place, I've seen that there are good people wherever you go. There are always people willing to help guide the lost tourist, the lost adventurer. As James Hazelwood said, our most memorable events in life, as in travel life, are the unexpected detours we took, the challenges we overcame, and yes, even those times we got lost. If you've been traveling or on a road trip and your car is broken down, you've made a wrong turn, you know those are the stories you talk about years later. That sometimes not even the destination is what is memorable, but the getting there. Travel takes us out of our comfort zones into the unknown. And there in the unknown are new discoveries about others, our world, and our very selves. Second to last chapter in the section is called Clean. By this, our author means coming clean and confession, not scrubbing the floors. He says coming clean, being honest, telling the truth, relieves us of the burden of carrying around a secret or any number of lies. As humans, we're hardwired to protect ourselves from vulnerable positions. So it can be hard, sometimes even excruciating, to tell the truth, admit our shortcomings, accept responsibility for our actions. Hazelwood said, telling the truth is an act of spiritual vitality and maturity. Coming clean, telling the truth, is helpful for us as individuals, but it's also helpful for us with our relationships, and ultimately it opens the door for us to be our most authentic selves. The final chapter in this section is called Serve. Service is a common expression of our faith. Here at Faith Lutheran, we've had more than once had a family call the church office or email Pastor Dale or myself and say, how can we and our children be of service either here at church or in our community or with one of our ministry partners? Service is about our faith being active in the world. So sometimes it might be something big, like a trip. So the Youth Works mission trip or a vision trip to Common Hope Guatemala, one of our ministry partners. But more often than not, serving is small and quiet, such as being an usher or a sound tech or a PowerPoint tech, maybe serving as a small group leader or a spark teacher or shepherd, serving at the food shelf or bringing a meal for families moving forward. James Hazelwood quotes American religious scholar Martin Marty, it's not what you gotta do, it's what you get to do. So it's not that we gotta do things to earn God's love, favor, and the promise of salvation, but rather in knowing that God's love and promise are freely given to us, we can count on it. And then we embrace the promise and are free to love and serve our neighbor. So while it's good to be worshiping here at Faith Lutheran together, we know that there are still many who are safer at home and will be for the foreseeable future. During this time of coronatide, if you will, Pastor Dale and I have heard from many who say they feel disconnected from God and spirituality. It's been a challenge in this time. And so Pastor Dale and I talked and we said, we want to find a book or a sermon series that will help us ground us all in spirituality outside of this beautiful building. And I have to confess, I'm typically a little bit leery of books about spirituality and spiritual practices because sometimes they make me feel like I'm not doing enough or being spiritual enough. And so I walk away feeling heavy and burdened and weighted down. Even James Hazelwood, our author and bishop in the ELCA, said that this has been his experience. This book, however, Everyday Spirituality, really is just that. The things we do in our daily life, in our weekly lives, God shows up. It's a big secret I've said on a few occasions. God doesn't just live in this building. Every aspect of creation, your home, your family, your day-to-day life, is permeated with God's presence. We are already spiritual beings. We are already connected to God and to one another. God is already showing up in the things we're already doing, in and through our daily lives. So faith isn't just a church. Faith isn't just about a building. Faith doesn't just happen on Sundays. Faith happens every day, in all of our relationships, in the simplest of life's activities. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Oh God, we thank you that you are with us in our everyday lives, with everyday spirituality, that you connect with us and we can connect with you in whatever we do, in our relationships, our activities, our work, and our play. We thank you, oh God, that you are as near as our breath, and as close as the beating of our heart. Help us to sense your presence all around us every day. Oh God, we do pray for your world today. We pray for all those affected by COVID-19. We pray especially for Heather and others that work in our hospitals, for first responders, fire, police, EMTs, for all who wear uniforms to serve us. We pray that you would keep them safe and protect them. We pray for healing for all affected by COVID-19. We also pray for those that are being treated for cancers, for those recovering from surgery. Pray especially for Joan Peterson today, that you bring her healing. We also ask that you be with those who struggle with anxiety or depression, for those that live with the challenge of addiction. We pray for strength and courage, for healing and hope. And we pray for loved ones who walk alongside those who are suffering or challenged in any way. We thank you, O God, that you walk with us all that we go through. We do pray, O God, for our country. We pray for those affected by hurricanes or fire. Pray for resources. We thank you that we can be present there through Lutheran Disaster Relief. We also pray for this political season of election, that you would guide our country, you would guide our leaders, that you would lift up leaders that will lead us in ways of justice and peace and mercy. Thank you, O God, for the country we live in, and help us to live out our citizenship in ways that would reflect your love and Jesus leading. We also pray, O God, for the gift of friends and family. We thank you for those relationships that you bless us with. We ask that you would receive our prayers, our thoughts, and all that we are. Receive us and bless us, and to walk with us faithfully. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Announcements are highlighted in your bulletin. Things coming up, as you see, baptism class, fall cleanup, confirmation service, trunk or treat, first communion class. Good things happening. I invite you to check out the website or Facebook for announcements and other things. I do want to lift up this book that Pastor Katie and I are preaching on, and she referred to, we've gone through the first two sections, and we'll finish up next week, but there are two different groups studying this book virtually, and I love it. I just finished it a couple days ago. I was reading a chapter a day. There's 27 chapters. It's a nice practice for a month, but I encourage you to pick it up, and or to order through Amazon. We do have some copies, I think, still in the church office, so I invite you to do that. For offering this morning, there's a basket in the back. We're not going to pass plates, or we don't have the fish nets out, but we're going to listen to our offering song, one of the things of everyday spirituality that we're blessed with. So we'll just sit back and listen to this offering of music.
Jesus, my Savior, oh, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your Tower of refuge, we stray.
years of which we cannot see the ending by paths yet untrodden through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.